I numb the pain at the expense of my liver. Don't know what I did next, all I know I couldn't stop. Word got around to the butterflies and the Baptist. My mama's phone started ringing off the hook. I can hear her now saying she ain't gonna have it. Don't matter how you feel, it only matters how you look. Go and fix your makeup, girl, it's just a breakup running.
Good morning, good morning. I'm Aaron Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. Listening to a little Miranda Lambert this morning.
Fun music.
Fun music. Well, we like all kinds of music. Well, we like both kinds of music, country and Western.
That's right.
And a bunch of other stuff, too. So glad to have you with us here on this Tuesday morning. Yesterday was such a beautiful day.
Yes, it was. And today is the last day of January. Soak it in, folks. Soak it in. 1 month down, 11 to go.
Is that a trip or what?
I know. This year's flying by. I'm not kidding. The January's gone quick.
It really has.
Yeah.
It really, really has. So we have to talk about the big news that happened yesterday. Trump fired his acting attorney general after she was defiant. An Obama holdover who was temporarily running the Justice Department just got fired by President Trump after an act of defiance. Mere hours after Acting Attorney General Sally Yates said the department would not defend Trump's refugee executive order in court while she was in charge, Trump made sure, that she was no longer in charge. Her announcement was her announcement was largely symbolic anyway, notes the New York Times, given that nominee Jeff Sessions is expected to assume the office of Attorney General in a matter of days. And Tobin, can you pick that up? Because I got to hold my breath.
Yeah, so basically, she stood up to him, right? But she knew she was on her way out the door. She is an Obama-era holdover, so she's not a Republican partisan, and she basically stood up to the president. But it's a meaningless thing because she was immediately fired, and the Justice Department will end up defending this if need be. It's an interesting thing. A lot of people are saying that it reminds them of the Saturday Night Massacre that occurred under Nixon. Now, Nixon's was, I think, a much more severe issue where he was actually the focus of an independent prosecutor that was investigating Watergate. And Nixon wanted the independent prosecutor fired, so he demanded that his attorney general fire him. And the attorney general resigned instead of firing this guy. And then the assistant attorney general resigned instead of firing him. And then finally, the third guy in line, which was Bork, and I'm just going to blank on his first name.
Robert
Bork, thank you, stood up and said, I'll go ahead and fire him. And that ended up becoming a big deal, right? And the special prosecutor was Archibald Cox. And so he got fired, and then they ended up appointing a new special prosecutor right after that because Congress was infuriated. And that actually was the tipping point for Nixon. After that, the polls changed, and people said, let's impeach this guy.
But this isn't anything like that. There's no investigation of the Trump administration, at least at this point.
Exactly. So this is a much smaller scale sort of thing. The only thing that's at all similar here is that it involves the Attorney General's office. And this woman will now be a hero to the left.
Of course. I'm sure that's why she did it.
Yeah. And, she was going to be essentially out of a job at the end of the week anyway, as soon as the new Attorney General took over. I think she knew that. The Attorney General, surprisingly, I read in another article, when this woman, Sally Yates, was up for her appointment to this position, he voted against her for this position. He doesn't have any love for her. Jeff Sessions does not have any love for her, apparently because she had said in her testimony when she was being vetted for this position that she would support Obama's immigration stances that he had taken in terms of DACA and DAPA. And
she's the chief law enforcement agent in the country.
Yes. And so, she was out the door. She knew she was out the door. And so she gets to go out the door, as, like I said, a hero to the left. But it is an interesting story. The president has taken a very dramatic position on immigration, specifically with this ban. People are upset We've seen lots of stories of people that are being sort of mishandled in terms of immigration, people who probably should be allowed in, no problem, with green cards and things like that, that were stopped and sent
But they got
back.
That worked out.
They did. They did.
So I think the biggest problem with what he did was the rollout. It was terrible.
Yeah.
It couldn't have been worse. It was terrible. He did a terrible his office did a terrible job rolling this out. Having said that, there's really nothing wrong with the president creating policies that I say creating policies. It's his job to enforce the borders, right?
Yeah.
And so putting policies in that allow or procedures in that allow him to do his office
yeah.
to do that is not a bad thing. Having said that, there are a whole bunch of countries that were left off, like Pakistan and Saudi Arabia, that should have been put on. I mean, if the goal is to extreme vet the parts of the world, people coming from the parts of the world that want to do us harm, why not include all of them?
Yeah, and I agree, and I think that's where the debate really should be focused is on. The efficacy of the specifics of this policy, the countries that were selected, the length of the ban, how it's being implemented, those kinds of things are certainly worthy of review and I think and to some degree rebuke, because I think, like you said, there have been some big errors made there. And for me, one of the biggest errors is that Trump is not a great communicator. And I think a lot of this would have gone down easier if the president had come out and said, you know, on this day, at this time, you know, I'm going to be doing this. Here's my reasons. This is why we've selected and proactively deal with all that. But
the administration says that would have triggered the people who want to do us harm to get here quicker in the window between when they said they were going to launch it and when they actually launched it. And they say that's why they rolled it out the way they did.
Well, as someone who's traveled internationally, there is no way to jump that gun or speed up that process. It's this long, slow process. If you're not already in the queue and almost at the front of the line to go, you're not going.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
It's not something where you can just show up at the airport, say, okay, now I've got my visa, my passport, and I'm going today. You really, there is a long process to travel like that and to get your ticket. So I don't think that's legit either. You know, I just think that they botched it, and now they're looking for lots of other ways to sort of blame other people.
I will say that, you know, I understand protests. We have the right to protest. We don't have the right to block traffic. And I say this, you know, they were blocking average people from getting to the airport.
Yeah.
It took hours to get in and out of LAX yesterday and the day before. It's stupid. You don't have the right to do that.
Yeah, and if somebody ended up missing a flight,
right? Oh, I'm sure there were lots of people who missed flights.
And they didn't have a refundable ticket or whatever. I would be enraged. I mean, you know, and sometimes people are, again, spending life savings to get these tickets to go on these important trips for things that they, you know, you don't know why someone's traveling. And I would be enraged. And I wouldn't be enraged at President Trump. I would be enraged at the idiots that block the traffic.
Well, and there's the other thing. I think people are not realizing that what they're doing is solidifying opposition to the cause that they're to their cause.
Yeah.
You know, that's it makes you mad at the protesters, which
exactly.
is not the outcome that they want.
Yeah, exactly.
It creates further entrenchment.
Yeah, I don't think they've thought it through. You know, honestly.
So imagine your mom is dying and you live across the country and you're trying to get to her before she dies, but then there's idiots blocking the terminals and you miss your flight.
Yeah.
Or imagine you've spent your life savings to go on a 35th anniversary trip to Cancun and you've missed your flight. It was a non-refundable ticket and now you can't go and you've lost everything.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, that's what we're talking about here, folks.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know why people think this is a good idea to block the traffic. And I'm with you. And not only that, it's risky too. We've seen these people have gotten run over by cars, you know, because people get really angry and frustrated, and sometimes don't even see. You know, they think, oh, there's an opening, and then boom, they hit somebody.
Right, because somebody steps out in front or whatever.
Yeah.
Yep. So it's time for a break. I'm Erin Brinker.
I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. We'll be right back.
This is Steve Allendorf from Rancho Financial with the Mortgage Minute. This may be the perfect time to move forward with a new purchase. The Feds have not yet increased short-term rates. When they do, we expect both rates and property values to increase. Today, you have an opportunity to qualify for a lower payment and more home than potentially even just a few months down the road. If you have VA eligibility, we can do up to 100% financing. We have loans with as little as 3.5% down, less than 20% down without mortgage insurance. Turned down because you can't qualify with your tax returns? We have special programs that we can use your assets to qualify you, and we have just come out with a bank statement program. If you can't qualify with your tax returns but can show income through your bank statements, we might have a loan program just for you. There are many possible options that can make a huge difference in your monthly payments. That's why you need a loan financial planner. Give me a call, Steve Allendorf, at 888-563-1070. That's 888-563-1070, or go to loanfinancialplanner.com.
Right in the middle of Redlands is a special place called the Tennessee Gardens, where great memories and romance abound. Under fragrant magnolia trees, beside seasonal flowers, and next to its whimsical ponds, brides and grooms begin their lives together and events are celebrated. With over 25 years' experience, its award-winning professional staff, led by Executive Chef Michelle, owner of Michelle's Bakery, create mouth-watering cakes and events. Celebrate your special event with people who care at the spectacular Tennessee Gardens, conveniently located right in the middle of Redlands. Make a no-obligation appointment to find out more about Tennessee Gardens. Call 909-793-5311. That's 909-793-5311. Or visit mybrideandgroom.com.
Balance of Nature's fruits and veggies.
I had gout in both my knees, and it's gone.
Well, I'm pretty stupid. I should have ordered it, 15 years ago. Best thing I ever got in my... It's the most effective product that I've ever bought in my life.
He had eczema on his hand, and it cracked for years. Mm-hmm. He did anything from doctor, every cream, everything. And 3 months on the veggies and fruit, it was gone.
They're just awesome. They keep asking me, what am I doing? I told them what I did with my cholesterol. I had the blood test, right? And it went down 100 points. 262, now it's 162. Everything is just perfect.
Call now to find out how to get your free month supply of Balance of Nature. Call 800-2468-751. That's 800-2468-751. Call now, 800-2468-751. Or go online to balanceofnature.com.
Use promo code TSL.
The Wild West comes alive at the Fox Performing Arts Center in Riverside with the world-renowned Cirque El Waz and its newest creation, Saloon. Swinging open the saloon doors and rustle on up for some fun with the entire family with his musical and acrobatic adventure. Live folk music combined with strength, agility, and original choreography for an action-packed theatrical thrill ride. Cirque El Waz, Saloon, Saturday, February 18th in Riverside. Tickets on sale now at riversidelive.com, ticketmaster.com, or 800-745-3000.
Loma Linda University Children's Hospital is excited to announce the 24th Annual Foundation Storybook Gala presented by Hard Rock Hotel Palm Springs, McCarthy, and MPS on Thursday, February 16th at the Riverside Convention Center. Join us as we journey through the storybook with an inspirational evening that includes live and silent auctions, dinner, and entertainment. As the only dedicated children's hospital in the region, we're asking that you help us write Happily Ever Afters through our Visions 2020 campaign. For more information or sponsorship opportunities, go to lomalindagala.org or call 1-800-825-KIDS.
This Hall of Fame jockey, Gary Stevens, inviting you to talk sports with the Open Season crew every Thursday at 3:05 p.m. on KCAA, AM
1050
and FM
106.5.
You're listening to KCAA, your good neighbor along the way.
Oh, you're gonna take me home tonight. Oh, down beside that red firelight. Oh, you're gonna let it all hang out. Fat bottom girls, you make the rocking world go round.
Welcome back. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA. So glad to have you with us here on this beautiful Tuesday morning. And there's an article that really caught my eye, really caught my eye, from the International Business Times in the UK. There's quote, substantial evidence the universe is a hologram.
No. Really?
Okay, that sounded really fake. No. Really?
Well, I don't know what to think, Aaron. That kind of title for that, it doesn't sound real.
Okay, so scientists have found, and actually our son and I have had conversations about this theory has been floating around for a while. The scientists have found evidence that the universe is a hologram. By looking at the universe just after the Big Bang, researchers claim to have discovered the first observational evidence of holographic cosmology, where the universe is contained to a 2D surface and we only perceive our 3D world. The idea for a holographic universe is not new. First suggested in the 1990s, it can be likened to characters on a TV show. They do not know their 3D world exists only on a 2D screen. In the same way, our 3D universe may just be an illusion. An illusion that can be tested. Dun, dun, dun! In a holographic universe, all of the information in the universe is contained into 2D packages trillions of times smaller than an atom. Advanced telescopes and sensory equipment is now making it possible for scientists to detect hidden data, revealing the white noise left over from the moment just after the universe was created. This is called cosmic microwave background, or CMB. At present, there are inconsistencies between quantum physics, and quantum doesn't mean very big. Quantum means very, very, very small. And the Einstein theory of gravity, if the universe was a hologram, these would be solved. Publishing their study in the Journal of Physical Review Letters, the researchers from the UK, Canada, and Italy looked at the CMB to make complex comparisons between the networks of features in Planck data, and that's Planck, in Planck data and quantum field theory. Their findings showed some simple quantum theories could explain cosmological observations of the early universe, more so than more traditional theories like cosmic inflation could. And the cosmic inflation, of course, is the idea that the universe is perpetually expanding.
Yes.
So observations can be used to exclude some quantum field theory models, while we also find models satisfying all the phenomenological constraints, researchers wrote. We showed that holographic models based on three-dimensional perturbative QFT are capable of explaining the CMB data and are competitive to the Lambda CDM model, the standard model of Big Bang cosmology. Okay, this is all really lofty stuff, yeah. But think about it. I mean, are we living in the Matrix?
Yes. Now, what's interesting to me, Aaron, is they actually have a graphic here that I think helps to describe it.
So yeah, but this is radio. Do your best.
I'm going to do my best to describe it. So if you can imagine that you're looking through a large funnel, right, and the stuff that's closest to you is the stuff that seems the most real, okay, and the stuff that's farthest away looks like a flat screen, right? Like you're looking at it on a TV screen far off in the distance, right?
Yes.
And there are different levels of screens at different distances. So the farthest one is the formation of the galaxy, you know, and then the intermediate one is sort of the young galaxy sort of as it's growing. And as it gets closer and closer, you get to the galaxy that we're actually living in, that is our physical galaxy. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. And so I think that's kind of how they're describing it. And so that what we're seeing or what they're studying when they look at these, when they're looking far off into the distance, is actually an old picture of what the galaxy used to look like. And that's why they're calling it a hologram.
So study author Kostas Skenderis from the University of Southampton said, imagine that everything you see, feel, and hear in three dimensions and your perception of time in fact emanates from a flat two-dimensional field. The idea is similar to that of ordinary holograms, where a three-dimensional image is encoded in a two-dimensional surface, such as in the hologram on a credit card. However, this time, the entire universe is encoded. Holography is a huge leap forward in the way we think about the structure and creation of the universe. Einstein's theory of general relativity explains almost everything large scale in the universe very well, but it starts to unravel when examining its origins and mechanisms at the quantum level, again being very, very small. Scientists have been working for decades to combine Einstein's theory of gravity and quantum theory. Some believe the concept of a holographic universe has the potential to reconcile the two. I hope our research takes us another step towards this.
Interesting stuff.
Very interesting stuff. So, yeah, we are living in the Matrix.
Maybe. But I'm real. The rest of you might be a hologram, but I am definitely real.
Yeah, but, you know, if you... You know, when you're thinking about, so everything we experience, is it all in our head? That's the next question.
Right.
It reminds me of the final conversation that Harry Potter had with Dumbledore. So is this whole conversation happening in my head, Harry asks, you know, when he's dead? And Dumbledore responds, what's the difference?
Yeah, exactly.
So on that note, we're going to take a break. And we get back, I'm really excited about this next interview. We're going to be talking to Sophie Sabaj. She's written a book called The Cancer Whisperer, Finding Courage, Direction, and the Unlikely Gifts of Cancer, which seems oxymoronic, but we're going to find out more about it. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. We'll be right back.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, K292 FQ Riverside, and K293 CF Moreno Valley.
NBC News Radio, I'm Sharon Reed. The nation's new acting attorney general is Dana Bente, a U.S. attorney from Virginia. He was sworn in late last night after President Trump fired Sally Yates for refusing to defend his controversial executive order on immigration. Bente will serve in the role until Jeff Sessions can be confirmed by the Senate. A committee vote on Sessions is expected today. Trump tweeted this morning Democrats should be ashamed of themselves for delaying the vote. President Trump is expected to name his choice for Supreme Court Justice tonight at the White House. Senate Democrats are promising a battle over that nomination. And an 8-year-old boy from New Jersey who sued after he was kicked out of his Cub Scout pack for being transgender says he's thrilled the Boy Scouts of America has reversed its policy.
We weren't just fighting so I could go in. We were fighting so this doesn't happen to anybody else.
Joey Maldonado was born a girl but has identified as a boy since he was 2. Sharon Reed, NBC News Radio.
It's time for your KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3 traffic report. I'm Erin Brinker. We still have that closure on the 74 westbound between Grand Avenue and Antonia Parkway. And actually, it's not just westbound. All lanes are closed in both directions in Lake Elsinore. This is the Ortega Highway, and it will stay that way until about February 10th. In Temecula, on the 15 southbound between the 215 and Rainbow Valley Boulevard, you have the usual stop-and-go traffic. And in Riverside on the 215 southbound, approaching Blaine Street, a ladder is in the lane, so please watch out for that. That could really damage your car. This has been your KCAA AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3 traffic report. We are the stations that leave no listener behind. I'm Erin Brinker.
Hi, I'm Jan Elliott in Snow Country. Well, it's been the snowiest January in 5 years for areas like Mountain High, and East and West resorts are open. Enjoy it at Mountain High, where they're skiing under the lights up until 10. Snow Summit and Bear Mountain, where they've got everything open, machine groomed pack powder, up to 5 feet of base. Mammoth is wide open, and the U.S. Free Ski and Snowboard Grand Prix gets to Mammoth. It's going to kick off tomorrow. Check it out at the Unbound Main Terrain Park at the Main Lodge. Bear Valley skiing and riding it all, and thanks to all the new snow, the Grizzly Bowl is open. At Squaw Valley, close to 90 runs and Alpine Meadows in the mix with 80 trails, machine groom hard pack surfaces. In Arizona, the Arizona Snow Bowl skis over 40 pack powder trails. And in the Rockies, Crested Butte, 20 feet of snow so far this season. More on the way, no doubt, as February rolls in. Get the details at snowcountry.com. I'm Jan Elliott on the trifecta of talk. 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM, the stations that leave no listener behind.
Did you know that 80 to 85% of children's brains are developed by the time they are 3 years old? The San Bernardino City Unified School District is sponsoring free parenting education classes for families of children ages 0 to 36 months. Classes include free childcare, a light meal, children's books to take home, and weekly giveaways. Graduates earn a certificate of completion. For more information, please visit www.infanttoddlersuccess.org or call 909-347-7313.
Like to spend a few days in another world? Then write this down. Golden Bear Cottages, Big Bear Lake. Now, listen, this is not some corporate-owned operation. It's family-owned and operated by some real nice people. Unique? Oh, you bet. Golden Bear Cottages features 28 one-of-a-kind cabins on a 5-acre historic site. Great for families, couples, and groups. And cabins are available with 1 to 7 bedrooms. Golden Bear Cottages is just a stone's throw from Big Bear Lake and super close to 3 great ski areas. Now, I could go on all day about Golden Bear Cottages in Big Bear, but to see everything, just go to goldenbear.net. Again, goldenbear.net. Golden Bear Cottages in Big Bear. Clean, comfortable, and affordable. Check them out. goldenbear.net.
KCAA, where every day is a great day.
Welcome back. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
We are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA. So excited to welcome to this show Sophie Savage. She's an inspirational writer, speaker, and facilitator who has worked in the field of human development, emotional intelligence, mindset change, and corporate culture change for more than 20 years. She's a UK resident, and she's written a book called The Cancer Whisperer, Finding Courage, Direction, and the Unlikely Gifts of Cancer. So, Sophie, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me, Erin. Glad to be here.
So I have to admit, cancer, unlikely is the operative word, gifts in cancer. How did you come to writing this book?
Well, I came to writing this book because, I mean, I was blindsided by my diagnosis, which was just over about 2.5 years ago, and I was feeling very well. I was 48. And suddenly I was being diagnosed. I was riddled with tumors in various parts of my body, and my life expectancy was less than a year at that point.
Oh, wow.
And I have a background in, as you've shared, I won't repeat my background, but what I found was, firstly, I nearly died of shock and fear, and I was watching people around me frozen with fear and not knowing what to do with their fear, especially us Brits. We don't really admit we're fearful. We don't really do that in Britain.
You have a stiff upper lip.
And I happen to have a background in that. And one of the first things I needed to attend to was my fear. I knew if I didn't handle my fear, I'd be dead soon. And so I spent the first 6 weeks really getting through my fear so that my fear didn't run the show for me, if that makes sense. Because if you don't take hold of your fear, then your fear takes hold of you and makes your decisions for you. So it was very important for me to do that, and very important for me to... I was determined to have a transformational experience and not a terrifying one. And that's what I've been having. And I treat cancer as a teacher and an opportunity for change rather than an enemy, which is how we tend to relate to it in our culture. The war on cancer, fighting cancer, the battle with cancer. I found that language very difficult to deal with. And I wanted to offer a different way of relating to it and experiencing it.
So what does it mean to be a cancer whisperer?
Well, I took that obviously from horse whisperers. You know, horse whisperers used to break, we used to break horses, and horse whisperers learned the language of horses instead of breaking them. Well, we've been trying to break cancer for decades, and there have been great developments, but more and more people are getting diagnosed. And I think cancer, like any illness, actually, illnesses point to what is out of kilter in your mind, heart, and body. And I think cancer can be a great teacher if you ask questions of it and start tuning into it and listening to it and saying, why did I get this? Not blaming yourself, but what are the underlying causes? What are the factors? What is this experiencing teaching me about how I'm living my life and what's not working about how I live my life? I think any big challenge in life can be a teacher. I just happen to get cancer, so that's what I'm focused on, and that's what I want for the other people who have this disease.
So, Sophie, this is Tobin, and I'm really interested. Hey. We've got a lot of friends of mine that are dealing with cancer right now, and you know, you mm-hmm. said that you were given a diagnosis that said maybe a year to live, and here we are 2.5 mm-hmm. years later. So what have you gone through? What is it that's kept you going, and are you cancer free now? Are you still dealing with cancer? Where are you at in your journey?
Good question. So I'm still dealing with cancer. I live with it. I live with it as a chronic condition rather than a killer disease. That's how I frame it. It's quite likely to take me out because I have a terminal diagnosis. But I think I've dealt with it mentally as well as physically, and that's been, I think, crucial and life-saving, because the mental part of it has allowed me to make very wise decisions about what treatments I do and don't do. I've said no to some conventional treatments that were really being pushed on me. I've also said yes to, I'm on chemotherapy, and I've had targeted radiation to my brain and my spine. So I'm all for orthodox medicine, and I'm in no doubt it has saved my life and extended my life. And at the same time, I've also done a number of natural treatments ranging from acupuncture to changing my diet, a number of things. And those two worlds, to be honest, in the UK, they're very pitted against each other a lot of the time. So my natural practitioners say, don't do chemo, it will kill you. And my oncologist says, don't bother with all that diet rubbish, just eat a normal diet. And they stuff you with sugar while you're on the chemo chairs. And you can get caught in the middle of that. But to me, integrating the two was just common sense. They've both got things to offer me. I know the natural things have massively boosted my immune system and helped me get through the harder treatments. You just need to be discerning and intelligent and do your homework, because there are people out there who take advantage. But if you use your intelligence, there are some great practitioners around. So I chose an integrated path and highly recommend doing that.
So what behaviors has cancer called on you to change, and where in your life is cancer causing you to be more authentic?
Well, great questions. So initially, and the immediate change was the way I treat my own body and my health. I'd come a long way with that over the last 20 years. But in my youth, I was very self-destructive. I had terrible eating disorders for maybe 10 years of my life, and I'm pretty sure I sowed the seeds of cancer way back then. So it required me to transform the way I eat, the way I exercise, and to actually stop the war with my body. I'd been at war with my body all my life, and I made peace with my body and made peace with all the things I judged about my body, and found great self-acceptance that I'd never found before. That was a big, big change. And alongside of that, I think you don't have time for pretense when you're as ill as I am. Your time is precious. Every minute is precious. And so I've ended false friendships, and I've mended broken relationships. I don't tolerate lies and much drama anymore. I'm ruthlessly honest with people. I think I'm much more loving and forgiving as well. And I wear my heart on my sleeve. My book is the most vulnerable thing I've ever done. And my blog, where it all began, I wanted especially us Brits to give permission to be really vulnerable and to find your strength in your vulnerability. But I think that's a universal need. It's been an extraordinary time, and I'm happier today and more fulfilled and more grateful for my life than I've ever been.
Now, do you
without question?
Now, do you have kids, and have you dealt with the family issues? I mean, what's that been like?
I have a late-life miracle daughter who I was told I couldn't have children, and I conceived her when I was 42. She's nearly 7 now, and she was nearly 5 when I was diagnosed. That has been the most devastating but also the most inspirational part of this experience, because I was grief-stricken, and I remain grief-stricken at the prospect of not raising my daughter, who is, you know, the joy of my life, you can imagine.
So we have about a minute left. Where do people find your books, and are you doing a book tour?
I'm not doing a book tour. You can find me Penguin Random House, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, most of the bookstores. It's now out in America. And my website is sophiesavage.com. And you can find me on Facebook, Sophie Savage, the Cancer Whisperer.
Now, you continue to blog. I imagine that people who are fighting cancer would find tremendous support and hope in your blog.
Yes, and that's on sophiesavage.com. You'll find my blog there on my website.
Well, Sophie, thank you so much for your courage to tell your story and to write this book. I know that must have been quite a challenge for you, and I'm very, very grateful that you did that. And thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much for your interest. I'm grateful.
So we are at a time for a break. So I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. We will be right back.
Farm and Ranch headlines. American consumers want dairy products, which means more production, but not necessarily lower prices. Stephanie Hill reports.
American consumers are buying more products with dairy fat, things like butter, cheese, and ice cream. Cornell Agricultural Economics Professor Andrew Novakovich says the scientific community doesn't see animal fat as bad for human health as previously thought.
There isn't really a strong scientific relationship between fat or saturated fat in a diet and heart disease, or cholesterol in the diet and high cholesterol in the blood.
Novakovich says producing more dairy products will not be a problem. But USDA dairy analyst Shale Shagum says a greater supply will not bring relief to the pocketbook.
We are expecting to see butter prices and cheese prices average higher than prices in 2016.
This is Stephanie Hill reporting in Washington, D.C.
Everybody knows healthy crops need N, P, and K. But what about S and Zn and B? Top yields require balanced nutrition, which is why you want NutriSync micronutrients from CPS. NutriSync is a complete line of essential foliar nutrients that supply the elements certain crops need where they need the most for optimum growth and performance. To make sure your crops are getting their nutrients, ask your CPS retailer about NutriSync micronutrients. It's nutrition on the move.
When it comes to a healthy bottom line for your farming operation, nothing helps like healthy soil. Producers who use soil health management systems report lower input costs while maintaining or even improving their yields. Plus, those systems help with drought protection and soil and water conservation. Contact your local Natural Resources Conservation Service office today to find out more and unlock the secrets in your soil. This message brought to you by the NRCS and this radio station.
I'm Sabrina Hill for AgnetWest.com.
The Osgood File. This is Charles Osgood. We take computers so much for granted these days. It was an event on this day in 1984 that helped to make the machines as common as television sets. It was an announcement by the late Steve Jobs, the co-founder and president of Apple.
Macintosh. Many of us have been working on Macintosh for over 2 years now, and it has turned out insanely great.
The story after this. On this day in 1984, Steve Jobs announced that his company, Apple, was about to sell a computer called the Macintosh. It was a machine designed to be simple. In fact, it was tiny compared to other computers then on the market. That was one of its selling points. Apple had bought an ad in the Super Bowl to introduce the Mac and to take a swipe at its competitor, IBM, which some at Apple thought was like Big Brother in the famous novel 1984.
On January 24th, Apple Computer will introduce Macintosh. And you'll see why 1984 won't be like 1984.
The Macintosh 128K was part of Steve Jobs' vision of the future. By today's standards, it was primitive.
And it communicates with you on a high-definition, super-crisp, bitmap 9-inch black-and-white screen, which has over twice the number of dots on its screen of any current-generation personal computer. You have to see this display to believe it.
It cost $2,500, around $5,000 in today's money. At that price, the Mac didn't exactly fly off the shelves, but it did set the stage for the computers we are all using today and every day. Steve Jobs died in 2011, still dreaming big. One of his sayings, get busy on the next great thing. The Osgood File. This is Charles Osgood on the CBS Radio Network.
Our Christopher Auto Center would proudly like you to know that Chevy won more 2016 J.D. Power Initial Quality and Dependability Awards than any other brand. And Mark Christopher is looking forward to another winning year in 2017. So come in for a test drive today at California's number one volume GM dealer, Mark Christopher Auto Center. Now, if you've got a Buick on your mind, you can save 35% on a brand new Buick at Mark Christopher. And if 35% doesn't get you in the spirit, nothing will. So hurry on down to the New Year's deals going on now at the giant Mark Christopher Buick, right on the 10 freeway in Ontario. Or go to markchristopher.com. Mark Christopher, California's number one volume GM dealer, family owned and doing things right since 1975. That's Mark Christopher, Vineyard exit of Interstate 10 in Ontario.
Broadcasting more local radio programs than any other station in California, we are KCAA.
Welcome back. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. Love that interview. I'm still really thinking about it.
Yeah.
You know, I there's such a connection. There's such a mind-body connection. And, you know, I'm very interested to, because obviously we skimmed the book, we'd have a chance to read the book, but I'm very anxious to go through it.
Yeah, you know, and as I mentioned, it seems like recently we've got a lot of friends that we know that are dealing with cancer, and it's difficult to see people and to see how they're dealing with it. And different people deal with it differently, you know. One friend, and it's not a close friend, but someone I know on Facebook, is at the end stage, and they posted some stuff yesterday, and they're at peace with it, but it's kind of jarring to see someone who's been dealing with something like that basically say, you know, I'm done, and like I said, this person's at peace with it, and I don't know their journey, but you know, it's tough. And then I've got a friend who's got a young son who's dealing with cancer, and you know, and the stress and strain that puts on a family, but you also see how close it's brought them, right? I mean, there's just so much love there. And I see in this book that Sophie's written, it's the same thing, right? That she's facing her fears with love for life and the people around her, and really just trying to be very conscious of making her life matter, you know?
I thought it was interesting that that she just, you know, ended friendships that she felt were false or, you know, yeah, well, just false is the best word for it. And everybody has people in their lives that they're not terribly close to, or maybe they don't feel supported by, or, you know, the connection's really not there, but you keep them in your circle.
Yeah.
And she just decided that she didn't want to do that anymore. Yeah. I think some of those people, you know, you find out when you go through something really difficult who is there for you and who is not. Yeah. And especially if you live in a culture where you're not, it's a sign of weakness to show that you are unhappy, upset, whatever. And the UK is very much like that, but the United States is too, with all of our, you know, weeping and wailing in on the macro about, you know, being offended or whatever. When it comes to individual, you know, the micro, we're supposed to keep that stiff upper lip as well.
I find myself to not be a very good friend when people are sick. And it goes back to some experiences that I went through when I was younger. My mom had a massive brain hemorrhage, and almost at the same time, my best friend was diagnosed with lupus, and they were both in ICU at the same hospital at the same time. And I found myself sort of shutting down and not being able to deal with all the emotion I had as my mom was sick and my friend was sick. And so since then, whenever somebody gets sick around me, I get this sort of deep sadness and sickness in my stomach, and I don't know how to relate, and I feel terrible about it. It's like I want to be able to be there for them and be comforting and supportive, but I don't know what to say, and it becomes so much about the anxiety that I'm feeling because it puts me back in that space where I was all those years ago. And you know, I know a lot of people struggle with how do you be genuine and relate to people and be supportive, you know, and it's hard because each person is so different, what they need, you know.
And exactly. Some people will want to talk about their illness. Other people want to talk about anything but.
Exactly.
You know, let's talk about shoes. Let's talk about the Kardashians. Let's talk about anything but my cancer or my whatever. And so it's how do you connect with people? I mean, I guess the key is having those strong relationships in place.
Yeah.
You need that anyway. We need the human, we need the interconnectedness. And I think a lot of what the social problems that we have in our country are because we've ripped our fabric apart. We don't have connected neighborhoods. We don't have connected families. We don't have, you know, the kind of closeness that as a culture we used to have. We don't know our neighbors. We go to, like, you know, look at the high schools. High schools are as big as universities in some areas. And we don't, we don't have multiple generations living in the same city necessarily, or in, even in this, you know, in the same house used to be the way that you'd have grandma and grandma living with her grandkids.
Yeah.
And obviously their parents.
And I'll share some. This might seem small, but you know, I'm a public school teacher, and I've been in the classroom for 21 years, and I've watched the changes. It used to be kids would come up and give teachers hugs, and teachers would hug them back, and because of lawsuits and liability and all these scandals with teachers and students, that doesn't happen so much anymore. In fact, you see a lot more where the teacher will fist bump a kid or give them a high five if they're going to have any kind of contact. And so we've created these walls, this separation.
Have.
And so people don't feel connected the way they used to. And again, that's a small thing. But
actually, I don't. I think it's emblematic. And I think this is why you see addiction skyrocketing, is people are craving that kind of connectedness, that kind of support, the kind of love that used to be part of our culture, and it really hasn't been. And I would think in the modern era it hasn't been. I think industrialization changed a lot, but I also think that, you know, the information age changed a lot.
You said connectedness, and that made me think of a funny story to finish on today, Aaron.
Okay.
Disconnectedness, the Cal Exit group.
Oh,
Cal Exit. They want to disconnect from the United States. And they now can start collecting signatures to put it on the ballot, Aaron. Isn't that exciting?
Oh, my God. Okay. We've said it before, but these are the guys that ridiculed Texas for wanting to do the same thing when Obama won.
I know, right?
And they're out here, you know, we don't need you. The reality is, California, yes, you do need the federal government. You want to talk about how much money you get from the feds? It's like $132 million a year.
Yes, well.
And California going to have its own army? Because a little country sticking out there all by itself, you don't think somebody's going to invade California?
We won't need an army, Aaron. We'll fight them with love.
With peace and love. Yeah. Yeah, Mexico would be on California in about 2 seconds.
So the group is actually called Yes California Era, Aaron, and they were approved by the Secretary of State on Thursday, according to the LA Times, and now they can start collecting signatures. They need to get 585,407 signatures collected by July 25th. And if there's someone rich out there that's bankrolling this, they'll get those signatures in no time at all, because they'll pay these signature gatherers, and they just stand out in front of the store. And half the people who sign those things don't even read them. They're just, okay, whatever. Just get out of my face. I'll sign it. You know? And they'll get their signatures, and then it'll be on the ballot. And then we'll have that pins and needle moment while we get to wait to see, will California vote to remain part of the United States, or will we vote to break off and go our own way?
So the people who are doing this, they said, I think we have the votes today, says a group co-founder who argues that California gives federal government more money than it receives, and it's culturally separate from the rest of the country. American already hates California, and America votes on emotions. And this is ads rep for the California National Party, which supports secession in the long term, but not the current effort. It's certainly as likely as Donald Trump becoming president. Yeah, 2/3 of the states have to vote approve this.
Yes.
It's not going to happen.
I don't know. Some of those states really don't like us. They're like, get rid of them. Get rid of
them. Well, then I'm moving. If that happens, I'm moving back to the United States to Texas or somewhere else.
Well, think about it. A bunch of those Republican states, you know, hey, if California leaves, you know, we've got this thing in the bag.
Okay. With that, we are at the edge of our show. I'm Aaron Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
We are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA. Have a great day, everybody.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM.
Good morning, I'm Chuck Kamlick, CNBC. Stock futures point to another day of losses on Wall Street. The Dow could be down 37 points at the open. Home prices rose another 5.3% last month, a bit hotter than expected, thanks to more demand and fewer homes on the market to sell. Wages rose 0.5% in December, more than 2% for the year. Earnings news dominates this morning. Eli Lilly's profits nearly doubled because it sold more of its diabetic insulin, Humalog. MasterCard scored more Christmas transactions that drove up its profits. But Under Armour sales and income did not rise as much as hoped. Under Armour, the stock will lose about 1/4 of its value in trading today. UPS will also be lower, even though it delivered more packages, but that still cost more money. Irish whiskey fans take note, with sales of that drink up 131% in the past decade. Drinks maker Diageo is coming out with a new version called Roe & Company, which it will make in the same plant in Ireland, where it makes Guinness. Chuck Kamlick, CNBC.
My number two does not look like a number two. I don't know what to call it. Is there a number three?
Table for four, please. Anything close to the restroom.
A middle seat with these stomach problems? That's my fear of flying.
Sound like you? If it does, you could be one of the many people with a digestive condition called exocrine pancreatic insufficiency, or EPI. Even if you don't know what EPI is, you might know the symptoms. Frequent diarrhea, gas, bloating, stomach pain. If you have even just one of these symptoms, you could still have EPI, because not everybody experiences EPI the same way, which is why it's so important to open up to your doctor about all your symptoms. And the good news is, EPI is manageable, so don't keep a lid on it. Go to identifyepi.com, complete the symptom checker, and use it to have a conversation with your doctor. Don't keep a lid on it. Visit identifyepi.com. Brought to you by AbbVie.
Here's the latest in local news from KCAA, 106.5 FM, 102.3 FM, and 1050 AM. Carbon monoxide from an electric generator is believed to have killed a man and woman at a vacant house in San Bernardino. Police said Monday the pair had permission to be in the house on West 11th Street. Their bodies and some drug paraphernalia were found in a bedroom over the weekend. No foul play is suspected. Police continue their full court press on mail thieves. A Riverside couple has been captured with a large amount of stolen mail, the latest in a series of arrests in Fontana. Officers stopped their vehicle for a traffic infraction and found checks, W-2 tax forms, government identification cards, and narcotics. Police said the mail belonged to more than 50 victims throughout the Inland Empire. A woman suffered severe injuries after a friend's dog attacked her in Harupa Valley. The victim, a 42-year-old woman, remains hospitalized. The owner of the dog grabbed a shovel to stop the attack, but may have accidentally hit the victim over the head. Eventually, the dog released her and ran away. And that is the latest in local news. Now it's time for traffic. We continue to have that closure on the Ortega Highway between Grand Avenue and Antonio Parkway. All lanes are closed in both directions and will stay that way until approximately February 10th. In the Cajon Pass on the 15 northbound before Oak Hill Road, a disabled vehicle is blocking the right lane. In San Bernardino on the 210 westbound before North Riverside Avenue, wooden debris is scattered across the lanes. And in Riverside on the 60 westbound before Market Street, a crash has been moved to the right shoulder. This has been your KCAA News and Traffic. We are the stations that leave no listener behind. I'm Erin Brinker.
From the KCAA Weather Center, I'm Rod Tanner. For this morning, we can expect sunny skies at a high of 76. This afternoon, it'll be clear tonight with a low of 49. We'll have a mostly sunny Wednesday with a high of 72. Wednesday night looks partly cloudy with a low of 48. Thursday, there's a slight chance for shower activity in the afternoon. We'll have a mix of sun and clouds at a high of 67. There's a chance of rain Thursday night. It'll be mostly cloudy at a low of 49. There's a chance of rain through the day on Friday. It'll be mostly sunny with a high of 63. That's your weather forecast for this hour from KCAA, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM. 3-in-1, the trifecta of talk in Southern California.
Go on an adventure. Embark on a once-in-a-lifetime adventure at the San Diego Zoo Safari Park. Experience Africa, the Tram, Cheetah Run, Lemur Walk, and the award-winning Tiger Trail, always included with admission. And make your day more wild with safari experiences like Flightline, Caravan, behind-the-scenes tours, and Roar and Snore sleepovers. Safaris depart daily at San Diego Zoo, safaripark.org, where every day is a safari.
Join Tom Hartman as he talks back to radio weekdays from 4 to 6 on KCAA, 1050 AM and 106.5 FM.
It's time to wake up. Do you have questions about financial issues and are not sure who to trust or talk to? Do you want to improve your financial situation and would like more education, guidance, and clarity around what to do? Do you ever wonder how you can improve what you're doing financially? I'm Daniel Choi, Chartered Retirement Planning Counselor and Certified Exit Planner. Join me every Saturday morning from 10 to 11 for the Financial Wake Up Show. Each week, I'll talk about essential things you need to know about anything related to your finances and answer all your questions as well. That's Saturday mornings, 10 to 11 a.m. Wake up with me, Daniel Choi, as we unlock the financial abundance you have within you on KCAA, 1050 AM and 106.5 FM.
This is KCAA. It's the Stephanie Miller Show.
It is the Stephanie Miller Show. Why, look, it's Yanira Johnson with her ovation, standing ovation hair. Now that is ovation hair. That hair got a standing ovation in L.A. and San Francisco.